As God has blessed us so generously, let's return our blessings now to God.
Thank you.
Let's bow our heads together in prayer. Loving God, as we look outside, as we go outside, and we see the sunshine and feel its warmth on our bodies, we can't help but celebrate and rejoice that the long, odd winter is over, and now we have truly entered into spring and summer. We see the signs of your glory at work everywhere. Magnificent fields that are being plowed and prepared and even planted at this point. The magnolias that have already come and gone and shown us their great beauty. The trees that are just now entering their full greenness, having passed through that bright moment in spring where their green seems almost artificial and just reminds us that you paint with so many colors and that you provide such beauty for us. And we're especially thankful, God, that we live in a place where we can come and we can worship and we can celebrate you freely, joyfully, and do so without embarrassment or shame. And so as we come before you this morning, we do so with hearts filled with gladness, but also with anticipation and hope. There are challenges and struggles in our lives that we must face every day. Despite the bright sunshine that falls upon us, there are dark moments, clouds perhaps, even complete utter blackness in our lives. And we know that if we tried to deal with it alone, we would fall. But with you by our side, with you in our hearts, we know that we can deal with these things. And so, God, as we come before you this morning, we pray that you help us to lose that darkness of our sin, that we might walk into your light. Forgive us of the ways that we have gone wrong, that we have broken your law, that we have broken the hearts of a neighbor, a friend, or even a stranger, the way that we have harmed ourselves. Forgive us, and by the power that came through Jesus' death and resurrection, forgive us. Restore us and bring us into wholeness. Help us to walk in the light once again. Receive from us now this time of worship, our praise, our glory, and adoration. Speak to us the wisdom and calming words that we need to hear, and equip us to go out into the world once again, serving as you have served us, following Christ's example. In his name we pray, and we say together, Amen. I think Anna's going to take Hunter for a little time outside, and Tammy is going to share our first reading.
Our first reading is from Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 to 13. There is a time for everything, and a season for every activity under the heavens, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to uproot, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to scatter stones and a time to gather them, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to search and a time to give up, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to mend, a time to be silent and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. What do workers gain from their toil? I have seen the burden God has laid on the human race. He has made everything beautiful in its time. He has also set eternity in the human heart. Yet no one can fathom what God has done from beginning to end. I know that there is nothing better for people than to be happy and to do good while they live, that each of them may eat and drink and find satisfaction in all their toil. This is the gift of God. And our second reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 50 to 57. I declare to you, brothers and sisters, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Listen, I tell you, a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed, in a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ.
We're going to sing, and Evie and Henry have already started for us. Today we start a micro series. That It's a two-week series. And over the two-week series, we are going to talk about a topic that was inspired by a member of the congregation. And whenever you ask a question like that, can you tell me what you'd like me to talk about? Can you give me a suggestion for a message series? It's a very risky maneuver because you never know what's going to come out of people. So today is Rest in Peace, and we're going to talk about death. That's a happy subject. And we're going to start with the book of Ecclesiastes, because the book of Ecclesiastes is a very curious text, and it's also a very frank and honest text. It gives us a very stark series of contrasts about life. It says mean things like there is a time for war and a time for peace. It tells us that there is a time for life and a time for death. And the interesting thing about the book of Ecclesiastes is that in its earliest forms, that is the earliest texts that we can find, there isn't a lot of mention of God. Ecclesiastes is in some ways almost an entirely secular text that has been adapted and adjusted for a people of faith. So it was so stark that it seems like somebody's added these passages to make it a little more palatable. Because the truth is, when you tell somebody that there might be a time for war, there's a time to destroy, there's a time to throw away, it seems kind of harsh, doesn't it? But it's not a text designed to make us feel depressed or upset. It's just an honest revelation of life. It speaks very simply and very clearly of the truths. And one of the truths that we have to face is that we all die. One of my personal favorite expressions, and I apologize that this is the billionth time you've heard it from me, is that life is a major cause of death. We don't get out of this alive. But death is one of those things that is terrifying, it's confusing, it seems unfair, but I would suggest that death itself is nothing to be feared. Death is nothing that we should be frightened of. It is, if all things go as planned, a natural conclusion to life. We're told we live 70, approximately 70 years. That's been bumped up to 80, 90, in some cases even 100 years. And you realize that as you go up in age, your body starts to break down and things become more difficult. We are built with a timer. There's no choice. At some point, we make a final exit. Now, sometimes disease or accident, life is cut short. And one of the difficult parts of death is that even though it's not to be feared, is that it does cause pain for those who are left behind. That's the issue. For the person that dies, pain is often over. I mean, think of how many times you've thought of a loved one lying in a hospital bed and they're suffering and their suffering seems pointless. And we've all had the thought, wouldn't it be great if they just went? Okay, it's an honest thought, I'm sure you've all thought it. I've even been asked it sometimes, is there anything we can do? Is it okay to pray that they go? Because sometimes death is a release from our pain and suffering. But if we live as if it's a thing to be feared, I'm afraid that we don't live at all. Now that's not to say we shouldn't take risks. We shouldn't do dangerous things. In fact, I've got a clip I'd like to show you just now of, it's called, some people call it free climbing, some people call it free soloing. This is the art of mountain climbing. Put the first picture up. That's my pop. The picture's not that great, but he is actually suspended by a rope. He's not just magically hanging there. This is when he was in the army, and actually, even as a hobby, he was a mountain climber. So this is him, and he has a rope, and it's fixed to the mountain by spikes that are drilled or pounded into the cracks. And you'll notice that he has little other safety equipment other than his rope. And in this case, he was just with a buddy. So there was somebody, I think he was the one hanging from the bottom, and there was a buddy up top. But that's traditional mountain climbing. Now, let me show you a clip of free or free soloing. I think you might have to push it again.
Free soloing has to be the ultimate in free climbing.
So it's a beautiful day to go out soloing.
To free solo is to go without a rope, to go without gear, to only have your rock shoes and your chalk bag and the power of mind. It's also very profound. The reason it's probably the ultimate is because one wrong move, you fall, you die.
Yeah, let me try that again.
And the person at the top of this game, and it's hard to even call this a game, is Alex Honnold. Alex Honnold is probably a perfect example of someone who's not only trained very hard, but is unbelievably gifted. He is like Michael Jordan.
Destination to another.
Yeah, I would say the Yosemite probably is the center of my climbing, that all my climbing goals, all like training, all kind of revolves around things that I want to do in Yosemite.
This is by far my favorite place for soloing. Because the walls are so inspiring, like everything here is so big, and that's like what gets me excited about soloing stuff.
One of the most memorable moments was pitch like 22 with a nose. I put my rope away and I switched to soloing. I just had a moment of like, this is like surreally cool. I was like, I can't believe I'm up here with no rope, just climbing. Like, this is rad.
Now Alex has now done the regular route on Half Dome free solo. So for most people on this planet who are serious climbers, doing Half Dome in a day or two is considered fantastic. Alex did it in 3 hours. Without a rope.
You know, you commit, you're like, I'm doing this, here I go. But then after like a couple hours of being all committed, you're like, man, I'm tired. And like, you know, your mind starts to get a little bit tired. And so I kind of stalled out, and then I started to doubt if I was doing it right or if I had the right holds. Why am I even here? You know, do I want to do this?
Just come back if you're not feeling it.
Well, that's the thing, is I'm like,
and that stalled him out, that paralyzed him. And then he overcame it. He didn't work that route 100 times. He just got up below it, looked up at it, and believed, absolutely believed, it was well within his ability.
And it seems like in this last season, I've sort of embraced the whole experience, you know, embraced the unpleasant parts too. It's kind of cool to just look around and, you know, enjoy the exposure, be like, this is why I'm here, like, this is awesome.
Did the words totally insane ever come to mind during this video at any point? I think that when it comes to solo endeavors, when it comes to just the human being, this is the riskiest thing I have ever seen. It's just a human being and a whole lot of rock. And you saw a couple times in the frame, you know, we would see him up close and then they'd zoom out and they'd zoom out, they'd zoom out, and it got to the point where you couldn't even see him on the face of the mountain or at the top. And I showed this clip because it is so on the edge. I hate to use this word, it's so extreme, dude. It's so risky. It literally, one slip of a hand and he's gone. And there are very few free climbers who live to their 60s or 70s. Now, Alex here is in his 30s. He's doing quite well, thank you very much. This isn't one of those where I say, and one day he missed. No, he's still climbing. And that, to me, taking that kind of risk is what it means to live. He's not disrespectful of death, but he's not afraid, or he's not letting his fear limit him. You understand that distinction? Now, I'm fully in favor. I'm a big Formula One fan. I love Formula One racing. And when you watch the original automobiles, and they were these big, clunky vehicles, little tiny, skinny tires, the driver was sitting fully exposed. I mean, half of his body was above the car. And when they were going at breakneck speeds, I mean, they hit 100 miles an hour back in the early 1900s in these little tiny skinny cars. And that was a crazy risky thing to do. And I am fully supportive of the equipment that they now have to help save their lives. I believe fully in having the helmets and the Han neck support devices and the cars. You know when you see the cars explode in an accident nowadays? That's actually a safety mechanism. If the car takes all the impact, it stays off the driver so they have a better chance of living. I'm fully in favor of all of these safety devices. You know, I like them in cars too. How many of you would think of putting your child in a car without a safety seat? And you've all pretty much adopted this motion, you sit down in the car and you go like that automatically. You don't even realize you're putting the safety belt on, right? It's just a safety thing. So there's a balance, right? There's a balance between the risks that we want to take and the risks that we should take. For something where we are strapping on 2,000 pounds of metal and going out and traveling 100 miles an hour, on the 400, trust me, that's sort of the average speed. You want protection, right? You want to do it safely. But that doesn't mean that we don't want to take risks sometimes. Like with this extreme sport, with this free soloing. If we were to be frightened of death all the time, we'd get nowhere, we'd do nothing. Imagine those first explorers setting out from Polynesia in those little tiny reed rafts and crossing the Pacific Ocean. Have you ever seen the Pacific Ocean when it's upset? Yeah. Have you ever seen the size of those waves? And they're going at it in these little, they knew that the chances were pretty good they might not come back when they went on their long voyages, but they took the risk anyway. And I think that's one of the things to think about in our lives, that death is not to be feared. Now, one of the things that Ecclesiastes points out, and one of the aspects of death and life that are a little bit questionable sometimes, and I hope to straighten this out today, is what happens after we die. What does happen after we die? Well, for most of the Bible, once you're dead, you're dead. Okay? Jewish tradition and the teaching of Scripture says nothing about an afterlife. It says nothing about us becoming angels. We don't become angels after we die, according to scriptures. That means that this life that we have, when we're born, that's God's greatest gift to us. God's greatest gift to us is our life. This life. This life is meant to be lived and to be enjoyed and to be celebrated. This life is meant to be protected and preserved, to be shared, to be experienced. And the reason I think Scripture, especially the early part, puts so little emphasis on an afterlife. There's virtually no afterlife in the Old Testament. The reason is because this life has to be what matters. You see, I think part of the fear is that some folks might be so busy looking for what's to come that you miss it, what's happening now. You're so busy waiting for that ultimate reward. You think what's going to happen after this life is going to be much better than what's happening now. But you end up looking there and not here. In other words, you don't live this life because you're looking for what's going to happen another day. It's kind of like salting all your money away in the bank for that rainy day. And never going to the show, never taking your friends out for dinner, never making those repairs around the house, because one day I'm going to need that money. So you invest it and sock it away. And then the question gets asked, how many times have you seen a U-Haul behind the hearse? You don't take it with you. This life is meant to be lived and to be spent. I think it was Hunter S. Thompson that said something like this. This life wasn't meant to go out with a beautiful body. This life was meant to go out screeching to a halt, battered, bruised, and saying, what a ride. Right, to experience it joyfully. So I think God intends for us to focus on the now, to focus on this moment, to think about our life and to enjoy it and to celebrate it, and not to fear death. Not to be afraid of what's going to happen. Because what's going to happen when we die is we die, and that's it. However, as Christians, we get a bonus. There is something more. But it's a bonus, okay? It's an extra. It's not a reward that we are given. It's not something that we strive towards. It's a miraculous transformation that comes about because of what Jesus has done for us. It's that new life that we are given. We are given a resurrection body. We are given not a second chance, but we're given the final, ultimate experience with God. We are, in effect, returned to the garden to be one with God. Now, there are certain qualifications for this. We have to live our lives as positively as we can. We have to be as Christ-like as we can, because in this model there is a punishment and there is a reward. There's no denial. If we live this life selfishly, if we live constantly breaking God's rules, and God's rules, by the way, are meant so that we can live together better, meant so that we can enjoy this life and glorify God. They're not meant to hold us back from living. They're meant to make us live more fully and to live together well and happily, and to remember who gave us life. So if we follow those rules, and if we live our life fully, then we're invited by God to be with him, to put on, as Tammy described, the immortal, to put on the imperishable. But that's a bonus. It's still this life that matters the most. It's how we live this life that matters the most, how we celebrate it, how we enjoy it. Not fearfully, not trying to live this life so we get the reward later, but living this life as if it is in and of itself the greatest reward we can possibly imagine. Our life for God, through God, following Christ's example, serving our neighbors and strangers alike, taking care of our family, glorifying God, rejoicing in that farmer's tractor plodding along, pulling his seeds, rejoicing at the fact that we can be behind there and know that that's going to happen. That's what this life is about. And that's where the title of my message comes from. You often see on a tombstone, "Rest in peace." Our loved one, we pray that they remain at rest and that the pain is gone. But I want to give that message to you. I want to say that to you, rest in peace. Rest in peace knowing that this life is the best life you can have. Rest in peace knowing that God has a wonderful plan for you in this life. Rest in peace knowing that if you live as joyfully and hopefully as possible, this is indeed the best thing ever. This is the greatest gift to us we can have. Rest in peace, my friends. Amen. Let's bow our heads together in prayer. Loving God, you are the beginning and end, the one who set creation into being, and the one who alone knows when it is time for you to bring it to an end. Just as you oversee the workings of the universe, you oversee each of our lives, and you know the course we will take and how long we will live. Yet even though you know our decisions before we make them, you give us the freedom to choose our fate for ourselves. You let us decide if we're going to follow you or not, whether we will love our neighbor or just look out for ourselves, whether we will be a blessing or a curse in our community, whether or not we will live life fully or simply let it waste away. As you let us decide, you provide for us the skills and tools we need, as well as the mentors and examples that show us the way. But you also let us pick our own helpers and teachers, even if they are more sinful than helpful. It is a big challenge, God. We know that living your way is difficult, but we also realize that it's the best way. When we live your way, we have no reason to fear anything, not because nothing will harm us or life will be easy, but because we will have the joy of pleasing and honoring you, and the joy of having made a positive, Christ-like impact in the world. And that's what we'd like, God. We'd like to honor and glorify you with our lives. But God, we're touched by so many other things through the years, and while we might be able to accept that death is a part of life, it's tough to see our friends, our family members die. It's hard letting them go out of our lives and finding a way to move ahead. It's hard to change and adapt when someone influences our lives so much. Hard to fill the void, even to find our own identities when somebody leaves this life. Yet we know that we can't change what happens. We can only find a way to grow from our experience, and to grow and to find a new form of wholeness, one that embraces the impact that a person that left us has had on our lives, and honors their memory without wallowing in sorrow or self-pity. We need your strength, God, your mighty arm to hold us up, to lift us from grief and to carry us to joy once again. Fill us, God, with the wisdom and understanding we need in the face of life and its inevitable conclusion. In other words, God, help us to live life in the face of death, not afraid of dying ourselves, and honoring those who have gone before. Help us to live lives that matter, to find our completeness even in our sorrow, to find wholeness even when someone close to us passes on. Help us to explore and fully realize who and what we are, and our place within this world. Help us to celebrate with those who celebrate, to mourn with those who mourn, and to live your life out loud, even when love is the furthest thing from our minds. Give us peace, God. Give us the peace of knowing that we are part of your great, wonderful plan. Grant us peace even in our pain, not that we might avoid it, but that in our peace we can find a way to deal with it. Let our peace reassure us that we're doing our best. And when peace is absent, help us to find the course of our distress. Help us to find a way out of the fear that makes sin uneasy and frightening. Hear us, God, and help us live joyfully and fully. For it is in Jesus' name we pray, and by his example that we seek to find fulfillment. Amen. And please rise for our benediction. Now may the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, and the presence of Christ himself be with you this day and forevermore. And together we say, Amen. Amen. We're going to sing.
Stay here.